We all think we know Grace and we don't. And reading this book was a really lovely insight into who you are and what you're about. But you're 27. A lot's happened. You're going to have to write 10 memoirs.
I feel old.
27. What made you decide now is the time to write the memoir?
Survivors are struggling to tell their story on their terms. And it's a blueprint in a way that I hope is helpful, not just for survivors, but for anyone who wants to pick up and read it. It was cathartic. It was confronting. It was also hopeful and empowering.
Grace was just 15 when she was groomed and raped by her maths teacher, Nicholas Bester. He spent only 1 year and 9 months in jail. Grace continues to deal with the trauma, along with other survivors.
The first child sexual abuse survivor that I ever connected with was this man named Steve Fisher from Tasmania. And he's like a middle-aged guy. And that was 7 years after I reported my experience. You know, for the first time there was somebody who understood what I'd been through, and he just dismantled this shame. I could just feel it dissolving.
Her campaign giving sexual abuse survivors the right to be heard saw her honoured last year.
2021 Australian of the Year is Grace Tame.
Discussion of child sexual abuse is uncomfortable, but nothing is more uncomfortable than the abuse itself. So let us redirect this discomfort to where it belongs, at the feet of perpetrators of these crimes.
As scared as I might be sometimes, and as scared as survivors might be sometimes, perpetrators are even more terrified now. Because you cannot take away that power that we are now giving back collectively as a force to survivors who were previously carrying this shame. That is going away. It is phenomenal, and you can feel it. I can feel it now. I have profound moments, one of which I gave a speech, and at the end they let people line up to take photos and chat if they wanted to. And I was on the stage, and even from the back of the audience, I could see that this guy was really nervous. He was probably in his early 50s and he was wearing a scarf. Now, when he got up onto the stage to talk to me, at first all he could do was reach out a pinky finger like this, and I could tell, you know. And I said, oh, can I have a hug? And at first he was a bit hesitant, and eventually he said yes. And we just had this moment together. We just held each other. And I didn't rush him. I knew that there were other people waiting. And he whispered in my ear that he'd been abused when he was 4 years old. The first time I was abused was when I was six. And it was really just powerful. It was just pure human connection. Before then, that man hadn't been able to bring himself to shake anyone's hand for 10 years.
Even as she helps others with their trauma, her own nightmare is never ending. In an extraordinary development, Grace claims that her abuser continues to torment her.
In recent weeks, you know, this man has used what we allege is his own open Twitter page to threaten a plan of revenge that coincides with the release of this book.
The tweets came from an account under the handle Nico Bester.
Bring back Donald Trump. Bring back Tony Robinson. I want to see Milo Yiannopoulos. Nico Bester is coming too. Oh yes, he is. Only 10 weeks to go, and he is coming to show all to you. Here it comes, only 4 weeks to go. The good old comeuppance on its way.
very few people would know my childhood email address, and it was the very same email address that was the login to my Facebook that he and I communicated on when I was 15, when the abuse was occurring.
So can police not do anything to stop him contacting and menacing and like, how can he continue to do this?
When I sent those screenshots to TAS police on the 6th of May via email, the response that I got was, oh, well, you know, if we even can get the IP addresses from Twitter, which is very hard to do, you know, it sort of like they were like, knowing and proving is two different things was the line that I was getting. Like, I don't know how many more examples that you need to show that this is a remorseless recidivist criminal.
I mean, you wrote in that you kind of wanted this book to be a chance for you to say goodbye to that chapter in your life, and now the timing of that is
it's hard. I really want to focus on the positives, and I don't want to be continuing to talk about that. And so, like, people have accused me in the past of being somebody who exaggerates things, and like I'm a known, or that I'm like, you know, I like dramatise things, or that I change my story or things like that. And it's not the case at all. That such is the nature of grooming and child sexual abuse, that as you age and grow, so too does the trauma age and grow along with you. And it doesn't matter how big you are physically, or tough you are, or smart you are to begin with. Once you are traumatised, your neural pathways are permanently altered, and that is how trauma works. It is not a force of logic, it is a force of nature. Of all the culturally ignorant phrases that I've heard in my time as an advocate, like, just get over it, is probably the worst, if only because it is scientifically impossible.
Grace's memoir also deals with her diagnosis of autism at the age of 21.
In the book, you talk about how, you know, people wanted to say, oh, the look that Grace gave Scott was to do with her autism. And you're like,
oh, no,
it certainly wasn't.
Oh, no. Well, that was because he's a lying, rotting, secretive... You can fill in the blanks. That moment, which was all of what? A matter of seconds. And I frowned at him. Granted, yes, he was the Prime Minister. If people are more upset by rudeness, which is subjective, than raping a child, that says an awful lot about what is wrong in society. We continually, disproportionately point the finger of blame and shame at children and at people who are coping with abuse, who are figuring themselves out, who, yes, they might turn to substances, they might misstep and stumble. Where, I ask, where is the proportionate shaming and blaming and questioning of the people who abused them and hurt them in the first place? Because I am not seeing it yet.
No.
Where?
That's very powerful, as we're probably expecting. What I love about Grace Tame is she is using her spotlight still, and it's not just about her story. She's taking all these other stories and all these other people, all these other victims, all these survivors with her. And I've seen people, even like yourself, Carrie, with the brain cancer stuff, how heavy that can be when you're putting people on your back and taking them forward, how heavy that can be. So, I mean, there are many ways that rage can manifest itself, and for Grace Tame to be using that rage to kind of keep this conversation going is so impressive.
I think also this through snippets and the clips and the short images you see of someone through the media, you can decide who someone is and what they're about, and it's not always accurate. And I think this book is the full picture of who Grace is, and it's worth a read because it's far more complex than the 10-second news grab or the image of her with the Prime Minister that you might see. Her memoir, The Ninth Life of a Diamond Miner, is available tomorrow. Details for her book tour are on our website. Thanks for the chat, Grace.